Yeah. Hello, everybody. I'm Matthias, and I'll talk about portals today. I've given basically the same talk a few months ago at Guadec, so if you've seen it there, then this will maybe be a little repetitive for you, and maybe you want to get a coffee instead, or you want to enjoy the rerun. So, portals. The Flatpak system of running applications, but I should start by explaining a little bit the origin story and the background of how we came up with this. Back when we first started at looked at doing Flatpak, building a system like that, the problem we were trying to solve was trying to understand why there was no real thriving application ecosystem on Linux. If you've seen Frank Karliczek's talk this morning, he had some very nice graphs comparing how many applications are there for Android or for Windows or for Linux. And the graph looked very I think it's getting a little better now, but it's still very tiny. So that was the problem we were trying to understand. But there's no real platform. Linux distributions all ship different libraries, so as an application author, there's really nothing you can rely on. And that makes it really hard to get your application out there to your users. Frank also had some really nice examples of how that is a problem, how that was a problem for him with Nextcloud. The really only options you have as an application developer is to try to get your application packaged for all the distros out there. And the moment you do that, how fast you can get bug fixes and updates out to your users, and you basically have no direct contact to your users anymore, and you cannot control what changes are made to your application before they reach your user. Frank had some examples for how that affected Nextcloud. And basically, the application becomes this middleman that stands between the application developer and the users that you want to reach. So that's not a great place, and but there's no many good alternatives. You could try to just build a statically linked binary of your application, so you don't need to rely on any of the distribution library stacks, and you don't need to rely on having an actual platform. And just try to put that binary up on your website and hope your users find it, maybe, if they Google for something. But then that leaves the user maybe in a bad position, because then he's left downloading some random binary from the internet and running it on his system. And if you think about it, that binary has full access to your home directory, all your data, and everything you have on your system. So that is maybe not a great thing to do if you don't trust the code, or you don't know what the code is trying to do. And traditionally, the trust comes in the Linux world comes from the distributions. They are supposed to like vet the code and make sure that no bad applications reach the end user. But we are trying to out from being the middleman between application developers and users. So that source of trust is basically no longer available. And we'll have to find something else to do. One idea is that make it less necessary to have this trust by coming up with some way of running the application in an isolated fashion. And that's what we call a sandbox. You can also call it running it in a confined way. Basically, a big part of what isolating applications from each other, so that one application cannot steal the secrets it might have gotten from you from another app. So that's the basic principle of sandboxing in general. That applies to, like, I guess, any sandboxing system. In the concrete case of Flatpak, this is what we make available to applications that run in the Flatpak sandbox. No questions asked. Every application gets a little bit of writable storage so they can save files. Obviously, the connection is necessary. And some parts of the file system are safe to access, like themes or fonts. And but some parts may not be necessary. For instance, a calculator might not need network access. And so the Jetpack Sandbox is kind of flexible. It allows you to configure what the application needs. And if your application does not need network or doesn't talk to any particular Dbus services, then you can just configure the sandbox to not make that available to the app. I should say that the configuration I talk about here is pretty static. That's something that you that you configure at build time in your application manifest. You say whether your app needs networking or any particular Dbus services. And users can override these configurations at the time that they're running the app, but that should really not be necessary. Now we're getting to the parts that are more interesting and actually different from running an app on a traditional Linux desktop system. These are the pieces that the Flatpak sandbox normally does not make available to applications. So the application does not get to read random files in your home directory or other parts of the file system, say /etc, or access random devices, or talk to services on the system bus. And that is not a big problem. Like, all these restrictions are very reasonable. And if the application was written with sandboxing in mind from the beginning, that's not a big problem. But with Flatpak, we really started from scratch. So we had no applications at all that were written with Flatpak sandboxing in mind. So we realized that we kind of need to bring existing applications along and make sure that they can work in Flatpak. And for that reason, the Flatpak sandboxing is very flexible, and we allow applications to define what access they need beyond the basics. And we call that sandbox holes. Some typical examples of holes that applications might want to ask for is, yes, I do need access to the home directory, or I need to talk to a few more services on the session bus, so please give me full access. Or maybe I need a particular device. And if you look through applications that are currently on FlatHub, you will find that most of them have some of these holes in their configuration and need them to function properly. Now, that's not our ideal end state. We really want to have a sandbox that actually ideally has no holes at all and provides meaningful isolation, because each of these holes kind of lets a little sand run out and a little dirt come in. And it's better if we can get rid of those. In the last year or so, we've started to try to figure out how we make progress on that. The first step we've taken is to just make it visible to the user what holes an application requests. This is a screenshot showing GNOME software, giving you this little pop-up here where it shows, I'm not sure which application this is, but it requests network access to the home directory, and a few other things. We also show that in the control center nowadays. There's an application panel that has some information about permissions up there, as you can see. But again, this is all kind of not ideal, and these static permissions and sandbox holes are supposed to be a temporary thing that we want to go away in the future. The question is, how do we get there? And given the title of my talk, the answer is going to be with portals. I should probably start by defining what I mean with portals in this context. Frank this morning talked about developer portals in his presentation, and he meant something very different, so I'll try to clarify what we mean by portals here. So portals in this context are basically APIs. It's a series of APIs that provide access to system resources and user data. That access is always meant to be under the control of the user. And this is a fully eliminates the needs to have statically configured sandbox holes. And for pragmatic reasons, we implemented these as Dbus APIs in one particular namespace, org3desktop.portal, which is more coincidental. I guess it could be anything, but that's the name we chose. To give you some idea of what kind of APIs we are talking about here, these are typical portal requests. Open a file, or save a file, or print a document. That's the kind of portal APIs that we currently provide to applications. And you might think, if you wanted to come up with a slogan for portals, much like dialogues. So this basically, a slogan for portals could be out-of-process dialogues. And in fact, a bunch of these actually do have dialogues in our existing desktop library stacks. GTK has a print dialog, and the file chooser, and basically the APIs that we aim for are at the same level as these dialogues. Here are some more examples. And I was going to say, while the most prominent examples on the previous page are very directly translatable into existing dialogues, some of them are a little bit more behind the scenes, say, play a sound, or take a screenshot, or get user account information. That's not something where we necessarily expect a dialogue, but at least these are also examples where clearly there's some access to a system resource or device is required. And yeah, I think I'll try to do this as a live demo. I wanted to show a portal in action. And we'll see if this works. That's always risky. So this is a little example application that you can also find on FlatHub, Flatpak developer demo. This is written in Qt, and it just has this little pop-up down here where you can try a few portals. So I'll try the screenshot portal. And so what happened here is the application that's running inside a Flatpak sandbox has made a debus request to the screenshot portal, and the screenshot portal has forwarded that to the portal backends, and that backend popped up this dialog and is interacting with the user now, because portals are most of the time meant to be interactive. And I get the opportunity here to make some configuration changes. If you've ever seen GNOME screenshot, this is basically the same UI. I copied it from there. And then the user can decide to actually take a screenshot. And now another dialog appears. What's important to point out here is there's this trust boundary between the host system and the application that's inside the sandbox. And this dialog is still like coming from the portal, so it's still on the host side. And I, as the user, get a chance to review the screenshot, and maybe I'm not happy with it, because it contains something that I did not want to share. So I can go back and I'll try again. Just grabbing the current window this time. Okay, that's a better screenshot, so now I can go ahead and actually make it available to the application, and now you can see the application got the data and saved it in the file. So that's how portals work in practice. I'll skip through this because I showed it. Right. The title of my talk was Portals Principles and Practice. So I need to have some principles at least. This is the one slide is principles. The guiding principles that we try to follow while designing these portal dialogues. Not sure they are super crisp, but ask the user is the first principle. It basically means that, in general, we want portals to be interactive because we want the user to be in control of what data gets shared or what devices get accessed. So that should happen most of the time. But we are not dogmatic about that. Sometimes it just doesn't make sense to pop up a dialog if you want to like get an updated network status. Nobody wants to like say, yes, please share my network status. So in some cases, we make exceptions. Next principle is be clear. What I mean by that is that the portal dialogues should clearly communicate what resources or what data is getting shared here or requested, and it should also make clear which application it gets sent to. so the user can actually make an informed decision. Yeah, we don't want to be annoying, but that what I try to mean by that is we generally want to try to make the portals interactive and have the user involved in doing a task rather than just having to click through some annoying yes-no dialogue. And the example of the screenshot portal, you could see that I was actually involved in setting the right configuration and then taking the screenshot, reviewing the image, and then passing it on. It was not just a yes-no dialogue. Last point is be consistent. By that I meant that we want to, the portal dialogues are out of process, they're running on the host side, they're not part of the application. So we want them to be clearly identifiable as portal dialogues and not part of the application. I'm not sure how well we are doing on that. As you could see in the screenshot portal example, that dialogue looked like a pretty normal dialogue and it wasn't really very clear that it's not part of the application. So we could maybe do better on that front. Yeah, moving on from principles to practical considerations. I've already said that our portal APIs are interactive for the most part, and that has some consequences for how we design the Dbus APIs, because we don't want like the portal to pop up a dialogue and then maybe the user walks away to get a coffee and then the Dbus call times out and things are in a bad state and we need to have error messages and try to keep the user happy. So instead of a plain Dbus method call, the portal APIs use a response object and a request object and a response signal. So basically you make one call to pop up the dialogue and then eventually when the interaction is done, you get a signal on this object that was created by that first method call. That also allows us to let applications cancel portal interactions halfway through. If it turns out that the application no longer needs the data it requested, it can just cancel the interaction and the dialogue will go away. Another practical consideration is that we split the portal's implementation into a front end and back end. The front end is responsible for providing the somewhat uniform API for all the different portals we have, and also for handling all the security aspects, validating arguments, checking permissions, and the backend is responsible for actually implementing whatever is the request at hand. For example, in the screenshot portal case, the screenshot portal backend just calls to GNOME Shell to do the usual flash animation and then get a screenshot in return. The last point is maybe the most relevant one. We're trying to make this easy for application authors, at least as easy as we can. So ideally, we want them to keep using the same library API they are used to. So whenever there's a existing library API that is a good match for what the portal provides, we're trying to retrofit the portal underneath the library. So for example, if you need to open a file and you're using GTK, then your application probably uses a GTK file chooser. So what we'll do is GTK will automatically notice that it's running inside a sandbox and then talk to the portal instead. So that happens transparently and the application doesn't need to do anything. Going back to that list of examples of portals I had earlier, here's just a listing that shows how the portal requests match to existing APIs. As you can see, it's looking there's a good overlap here, and we don't have to introduce many portal-specific APIs. It gets a little, there's some gaps here on the second page, and third page as well. What we recently did is we introduced a library called libportal, which is providing wrapper APIs for all the portals. So that should cover the gaps in the list. And make it easier to use the portals because, as I said earlier, the Dbus API is not the most straightforward one. One example I wanted to briefly talk about here is the last one because it's interesting. Access to settings. We do have G settings for that in glib as the API that most GNOME applications at least use. And I think for settings, you wouldn't necessarily expect that there needs to be simple key file or whatever file format it prefers in its local storage space and wouldn't have to like talk to any Dbus APIs at all. The fact that we need a portal here is just due to the fact that under these G settings we are using dconf, which has a kind of centralized storage architecture where there's a single database that stores all the application settings in one place, which is not a great match for a system where we want to isolate applications from each other. That's why this shows up here. But in fact, what we've done there is to change the G settings backend to do exactly what I just said. If G settings recognizes that we're in a sandbox, it'll just write to a simple key file inside the application's writable storage area, so we don't need any portal interaction. The one exception to that is that GTK and some other desktop libraries also use G settings for things that are more desktop-wide settings, like your preferred font or the theme, things like that. So for that, we do have a simple read-only settings portal. Right. So what are the pros and cons of this system that I've described so far? I start with the disadvantages, so to maybe end on a positive note in the end. One disadvantage is that some UI patterns that we have in desktop applications just don't work very well with this enforced trust boundary. Examples here are anything where we embed system information inside the application UI. And the two examples I came up with for that is recent files. If you have a traditional menu with a file menu and you get this submenu that has all your recently opened files, or maybe it has all the recently opened files from the whole system, that's information that in a Flatpak sandbox scenario the application may not necessarily have. Another example from the menu space is open with menus, like in the file manager, where you have a right-click on a file and you get a context menu that has an open with submenu that lists all the available applications that can handle a certain file type. That's again information that the application in the sandbox might not have. Yeah, and then there's things like extensible dialogues. The GTK file chooser lets applications embed random widgets in various places, which is just not something you can do if the dialogue is out of process. And the print dialogue has similar issues. And I think I'll just skip to show this. This is the example screenshot for recent files. So this is not a UI you can easily do inside a sandbox because those files come from anywhere and are not necessarily accessible to the application. And this is the example for the extensible file chooser dialog. That little character encoding combo box here at the bottom is something that I believe gedit manually adds to the file chooser. So those things are not easily reproduced in the portal. And then there's some other more technical limitations due to the implementation of how we handle files in portals. We cannot easily implement opening a whole directory. Instead, the portal only gives you access to individual files, one file at a time. And it turns out that some applications really want to open directories, so we probably have to figure out a way to do that eventually. But there's also some advantages. Obviously, sandboxing is the biggest one. That's why we do this in the first place. But I also wanted to mention that this portal API system gives us a bit of a portability layer. You could even look at it as a way to make applications more portable. If you only make portal requests, they're very high level and they can easily be implemented in different ways on different platforms. That's an advantage. And finally, something that people wanted for a long time from GTK is to have native dialogues. Like, typically, the request would be to use the Windows file chooser if you're on Windows and you're using GTK. That's something we haven't had for a long time. But with portals, you basically get that for free because the portal dialogue is out of process and can use whatever you want. And in fact, the GTK file chooser native interface that we're implementing here for the portal support was added to GTK particularly to enable using native file choosers on Windows. But we could just reuse the same interface for portals as well. And yeah, when I mean native here, I don't just mean Windows. Another example of native dialogues is that you actually, if you run a GNOME application in a Flatpak on a KDE desktop, you'll get a KDE file chooser or a Qt file chooser. And yeah, vice versa as well. Federico recently reminded me that I actually just to prove a point, at some point I wrote a quick portal implementation that used the GTK2 file chooser. So you can actually bring back a good old file chooser that some people are still longing for using the portal technology. Right, so no software is ever completely finished. That's also the case for portals. There's some things that you all can do to help us make this better. If you have an application that's already flat-packed, you should make sure that it uses the portals that we have. And if your application is not flat-packed yet, you should probably look into that first. And the easiest way to use existing portals is to use the portalized library APIs. As I said, if you're currently using a file chooser dialog, you can just switch to use the GTK file chooser native interface, and you'll get portal support for free. Similarly, for launching applications, if you currently manually use a gdesktop app info and launch it with some of those APIs, if you switch to gappinfo launch default, again, that'll magically add portal support to your library, to your application. And if you want to use a portal that does not have a direct GTK API equivalent, you can use libportal now. That's very new, and I'd be quite happy to get some feedback on how well that works for applications. Yeah, if you're using G settings and you have a Flatpak already, then it's quite likely that your manifest is poking a sandbox hole for dconf, because that was necessary until about half a year ago, I think. But now it would be a good time to just remove the dconf hole and see if the portal support for G settings works as intended. But there's more you can do. You could just tell us what portals would help your application to need less direct system access and less sandbox holes. That's very useful information. And maybe you can even implement some of those portals yourself if you're so inclined. Of course, people have given us suggestions already. Here's a list of ideas for portals that we've collected over the last few years. And some of them make a lot of sense, I think, and we should really have portals for that. Say, set a background image, or maybe get contact information. Those are good examples and very reasonable requests. Thankfully, since I last showed this list at GuardEC, we've actually made some progress, and a few of these have been added recently to the XCG desktop portal implementation, so will be available with the next release very soon. I think that is pretty much what I had. So if you want to learn more about portals, you can go to that GitHub repository where they live, and the documentation for portals is available on readthedocs.io, where the rest of the Flatpak documentation lives. And with that, thanks for your time, and any questions?
So if I'm a desktop environment developer and I want to make sure portals are awesome in my desktop environment, is libportal something for me, or is that just for application developers?
No, libportal is really exclusively for application developers. It's just to take the pain out of talking to portals directly via dbus. All right. Well, thanks again.